Ultra beast, negative, nepotist. Everybody waiting for the fall of man. Everybody praying for the end of times. Everybody hoping they could be the one. I was born to run, I was born for this.
Whip, whip, run me like a racehorse. Pull me like a ripcord. Break me down and build me up. I wanna be the slip, slip. Word upon your lip, lip. Rather that you rip, rip. Break me down and build me up. Whatever it takes. Cause I love.
Hanging on to the visual, I wanna be invisible. Looking at my ears like I'm out of dumb. Everybody needs to be a part of them. Never be enough from the prodigal son. I was born to run, I was born for this.
Whip, whip, run me like a racehorse. Pull me like a ripcord. Break me down and build me up. I wanna be the slip, slip. Word upon your lip, lip. Rather that you rip, rip. Break me down and build me up. Whatever it takes.
All right, everybody. Whatever it takes. That's right. We are here for our deep dive session in FAR, and we have a lot of great stuff to go over with you. Let me introduce myself. My name is Mike Potenza, and I'm going to be taking you through about 2 hours, give or take, everything you need to know to pass this exam. And Anya, Josh, I don't hear anything from you guys, so I assume you see my screen. You can hear me. Everything's good. If it's not, definitely let me know. Before we jump in, we did email out a handout, and that handout that I sent is going to match my deck, and it's got a lot of the roots of what I'm going to go over with you, but it doesn't have everything in it because I need you to pay attention. I need you to either take some notes there, online, whatever you're going to do, because the key to understanding bonds is to practice and to be able to do it yourself. If I just give you all the answers, it's not going to work for you, all right? Believe me, I've taught bonds to a lot of students, and I need you to understand what's going on. So with the handout I gave you and me walking you through it and filling it in, you should be in great shape, okay? Now, listen, we at Becker, we've been putting a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of money into making sure we have the best quality product out there. It's true for these deep dives. It's true for our textbooks. It's true for our videos, our questions, you name it. And if you're studying with us and you ever have any issues, you know what you can do. You can contact our academic support team. They're there 24 hours a day. You could contact me. I give everybody my LinkedIn right there. Feel free to contact me anytime. I always check my LinkedIn because we have one goal in mind, and that is to make sure whether it's your first time you're taking the exam, the second time, it is your last time. And we want to put the best product out there and make sure you do it. So that's what these deep dives are all about. And at the end, I'm going to give you a deep dive schedule for a lot of the other exams and the other sections that we have coming up in the not too distant future. So make sure you hang around for that. And we're even running specials where you could click some barcodes and, you know, save a whole bunch of money, all good stuff. So I have a bunch of people in the background. I have Josh and Karen and Anya and the rest of the team back there. And if you have any questions, please use the Q&A and put that questions in there, and they'll be answering those questions for you very, very quickly. All right. So with that said, here is what we're going to be covering tonight. It's all about order. I want to give you from basics to advanced, and I want to give you steps to follow so that if you see any of these questions on the exam, you're going to say, oh my God, Mike went over that. I know exactly what to do here, because it's the same thing over and over, and repetition is key. And once you get through this deep dive and you understand the examples I give you here, and then if you are a Becker student and you do all of our multiple choice questions and you do our task-based simulations and our practice exams, our mini exams, our simulated exams, if you follow our plan, there's an excellent chance you're going to pass. We have something known as Exam Day Ready, and it was audited by a public accounting firm. So it took them a year to go through all of our results, and they said if you follow the Becker plan and you qualify for Exam Day Ready, already, 94% chance you're going to pass the exam the next time you take it. And it's funny, a lot of other competitors may say the exact same number out there, but we're the only ones that went to a public accounting firm, and it's proven, all right? So stay with me in this. We got about 2 hours. If I can take a break, I will. It depends how we move around, but we have some great, great information here. And at the end of this, you know what you're going to be saying to the AICPA. Come on, give me bonds. I dare you, all right? So let's do this. First part of it, topics 1 through 5, we're going to go over the basics of bonds, terminology, then the bonds issuance. What does it mean to issue a par, at a discount, a premium? What are issuance costs? What are the issuance journal entries? I go over all of that. Then we move into the next part, 6 through 10. That's when we look at understanding our interest payments, our amortization, our journal entries. What's the straight line method? What's the effective interest method? All great stuff that you need to know because they test it all. And then time permitted, I'll briefly talk about bonds issued in between interest dates. That's kind of a deep dive topic on its own. So we're going to kind of scratch the surface on that. But in our program, we go into it in a lot more detail. Just in 2 hours, we don't have enough time to do it all. But the majority of the information, 95% of the information that you would see on the exam is going to be covered tonight in bonds. So let's jump right in. Let's do it. Let's start with bond basics. So a couple things you need to know about bonds. What is it? It's nothing more than a long-term liability, okay? It means a company needs money. And they say, well, if we want to raise money, maybe we want to buy more resources, we want to hire more people, buy new equipment, they could sell ownership, right? They could sell shares. We call that selling equity. But if you sell equity, you dilute your ownership. So if the company makes a profit, you get less profit as a shareholder because there's a lot more shares outstanding. So wouldn't it be great if we could raise money and not sell equity? Absolutely. We call that borrowing money, creating debt. And that's all corporate bonds are. Borrowing money from someone, promising to pay them interest, and then pay them back when the bond matures. So the biggest thing about bonds, no ownership interest is sold. You're just borrowing money, promising to repay it. So the way it works is you have some investor, someone with money, and they say, you know what? I think you're a pretty good, solid, stable company. I'll lend your company some money, but only if you promise to pay me some interest over time, and then at a certain date, give me my money back. And that's all that's going on with bonds. That's it, okay? Now, usually with bonds, you pay it all back, the principal, we call it, at the end of the bond, a 5-year bond, 10-year bond, whatever it is, you pay it at the end, one lump sum. There is something known as serial bonds that they don't test that much. That's when you pay the principal back in stated intervals instead of paying it all back at the very end, but not really a big deal. Now, a bond indenture, that's the actual contract. It's the document that lists all the terms of the bond agreement between the borrower, the company that wants to borrow the money, we call it the issuer. The borrower issues the bonds to the lender. The lender buys the bond. They are the bond holder, okay? Now, every bond has something known as a face value, but I'm going to use the term par value. That's usually what we use. We talk about the par value. It means the same thing as the face value. Face value, par value, it's the total dollar amount of the bond. And what we need that for is to calculate the interest payment, all right? So we need the face value or the par value, I'll call it, to calculate the interest payment. Normally, if they don't tell you how much the bonds are for, but they give you an amount of bonds are usually in increments of $1,000. So if they said, oh, such and such issued 10 bonds, you'd go, oh, 10 times 1,000 is $10,000. And that's the face value, all right? So if they don't tell you the face value, you assume it's $1,000 per bond and you check the number of bonds. So we have this par value. What happens 99% of the time outside of something like serial bonds, that principal, if it's $1 million in bonds, has to be paid at maturity. So you borrow $1 million and then you pay interest over time. And then at the maturity, if it's a 5-year bond, when the 5 years is up, you pay the full $1 million back at maturity. Okay. That's true if the bonds are sold at par, if the bonds are sold at a discount, or if the bonds are sold at a premium. And I'll explain all the difference on what that means. Now, when you learn about your statement of cash flows, right, you learn, okay, I have operating cash flow, financing cash flow, investing cash flow. When you pay the principal back, that is known as financing cash flow, all right? Paying the principal is considered financing for your statement of cash flow. Now, we're going to see the interest is different. The interest payments, they basically are going to be operational, all right? So you have to make sure you know that, and I'll get to that in just a bit. Now, let's talk about some definitions for some interest rates. All right. On the document itself, the bond, it will have what's called a stated interest rate, all right? It's the interest rate of the bond. They could call it the stated interest rate. They could call it the nominal interest rate. They can call it the coupon rate. They can call it whichever of the ones they want. They all mean the same thing. I'm going to use the term coupon rate today, all right? So I'm going to use par value. I'm going to use coupon rate. Par value is a face value. Coupon rate is the interest rate of the bond. Then we have this stated interest rate. What we're going to use that for, we're basically going to use that to calculate the interest payments. And it's going to be really simple. We're going to do the face value times the coupon rate, and we're going to calculate interest payments. So I'll show you how to do that. And as I mentioned, interest payments for your cash flow statement, operating cash flow. Paying back the principal is financing, interest payments, operating, in case that ever comes up in a multiple choice question. Now, we have a second type of interest rate known as the market or the effective interest rate, which could also be called the yield to maturity. It could be called the yield or simply the market rate. So I'm going to call it the market rate. So we're going to have the coupon rate is the interest rate of the bond, and the market rate is the interest rate of just that, the market. All right. Now, we're going to use this market rate for calculating an interest expense that we can take on our income statement. Now, the thing about that is we're going to learn a par value. The interest expense and the interest payments are the same. But if the market rate and the coupon rate are not equal, well, then the interest payment and the interest expense are not going to be equal either. And I'm going to get into that just so you're aware. So I want you to keep this in mind. The coupon rate, this is the rate used when we calculate the interest payments that we have to pay the bondholder, right? The issuer pays the interest to the bondholder, use the coupon rate. The market rate, that's going to be used for calculating the allowable interest expense that we can take on the income statement, all right? So do not get these two mixed up. This is one of the keys to understanding bonds, all right? Now, bonds can also be secured or unsecured. So when we talk about a bond being secured or unsecured, here's the difference. Debenture, that's what we call an unsecured bond, all right? It means it's backed only by the issuer's creditworthiness. So you say, well, listen, I'm not going to buy a bond in that company if I think they're going to go bankrupt, right? They have a really low credit score, but you don't mind buying corporate bonds from companies you know are very strong and they're going to be around for a long time, right? So you have to look at their creditworthiness. So keep this in mind. When we're talking about unsecured bonds like a debenture, we're saying there's no collateral, so there's going to be more risk involved. Whereas some bonds are secured by something such as a mortgage bond. Mortgage bond is going to be secured by some type of real property, some real estate, a house, a building, some land, something like that. Collateral trust bonds are bonds that are secured usually by some other type of investment, maybe shares of Apple stock or Amazon or something along those lines. Now, some other things that they don't really test that frequently, callable bonds, that's when the issuer could pay back the principal early, all right? They can pay it back prior to maturity. Convertible bonds is a whole nother area of financial where we spend some time on it. So we're not going to get into convertible bonds here, but really this is more of a protection for the bondholder that if they own stock and if the stock, they're afraid is going to fall too low, this can give them protection against the stock price falling. But again, nothing we need to worry about here. There's a whole nother area of financial where we go into this in a lot more detail. All right. You should know what zero coupon bonds are. So you ask yourself, what exactly is it? All it is, unlike your normal corporate bond, it's a bond where the issuer does not make any interest payments over the life of the bond. The coupon rate is zero. So you go, wait a minute, Mike, why in God's name would I buy a zero coupon bond if I don't get any interest payments on it, right? I just give them my money and they give it back to me? No. What happens is at the end of the bond, they will pay you one big payment, one lump sum. You say, yeah, Mike, but that's what they do for corporate bonds. They pay the principal at maturity. That's right. Zero coupon bonds is a little different. The zero coupon bonds are sold at a discount. They're sold for less than the face, less than the par value. In other words, it's called being sold at a discount. So think about it this way. You buy a 5-year zero coupon bond for $8,000, but when it matures in 5 years, you get paid $10,000. So what's happening, the difference between what you get paid on maturity versus what you paid, that's the difference. That's really, think of it as the interest earned. So in that example I just gave with you, there's a $2,000 spread, right? You paid $8,000 to buy it, but you got paid $10,000 on the back end. So that's a $2,000 increase or profit for you. That's considered over the 5 years going to be the interest payments that they didn't pay you over time, but they just gave you all at the very end. Okay, so not a big deal. Those are zero coupon bonds. Okay, key points in bonds I want you to be aware of. First one, anytime they give you an example and the market rate equals the coupon rate, we're going to sell the bonds at face value. You need to know that. You need to memorize it. And that basically means that, all right, listen, my coupon rate on this bond is 8%. And my market rate, if I invest in the market, is 8%. So wherever I invest, I'm going to get 8% return on my investment. So I don't really care which one. Maybe I invest in the market. Maybe I buy the corporate bonds. Neither one is more desirable. That's why they sell at face value. That's the easiest case. You hope you get that one on the exam because that's a walk in the park. If the market rate is greater than the coupon rate, then the bonds need to be sold at a discount. Why? Because the market, investing in the market's more desirable. In other words, think about it this way. Market rate is 8%. Coupon rate's only 6%. If you had money to invest, would you rather make 8% on your money or 6% on your money? You'd rather make 8%, so you're going to invest in the market. But me, the company trying to issue bonds, I want you to buy my bonds. And it's hard to compete against the market because I can only give you 6% on my bonds, but the market's giving you 8%. So you know what? I'll put them on sale. Hey, instead of paying me the $10,000 face value, pay me $9,000, right? So I make it more enticing because I sell it to you at a discount. Opposite is true when the market rate is less than the coupon rate. Here you issue bonds at a premium. They sell for higher than face value. Why? Because your bonds are more desirable. Think about the market rate being 6%, but your coupon rate being 8%. Investors are going to say, I don't want to make 6% investing in the market. I'd rather make 8% buying your bonds. So I'm willing to pay a little more money for your bonds because I'm going to make an extra few percent. All right. So that's how it works. You pay a little more than face value. You sell them at a premium. So keep this in mind. If you ever issue bonds at a premium or a discount, you know the market rate and the coupon rate are not equal. All right. They're going to be different. Next thing, I already told you that the face of the par value of a bond is generally $1,000, all right? So you'll sell the bonds for $1,000 when the market rate equals a coupon rate, that's selling it at par, all right? So if they told you you had 1,000 bonds and you sold them at market rate, 1,000 bonds times $1,000 a bond would be $1,000,000. And I'm going to use that number in my examples, a million, because it's a nice, round, easy number to use. But if they tell you the bonds are sold at 95% or 0.95, you know they're being sold at a discount because instead of selling for $1,000 a bond, they're selling them at $950 because the market rate is greater than the coupon rate. So in that example, if you sold 1,000 bonds, well, you have to multiply those 1,000 bonds times $1,000 per bond on the face, but then you multiply it by 0.95 and you're only going to collect $950,000. You're selling them at a discount. And the opposite is true if you sell the bonds for a premium. If you sell them at 105 or 1.05, you're selling them at a premium because the market rate's less than the coupon rate. So if you sold 1,000 bonds at $1,000 each, it's $1,000,000, but you times it by the 1.05 and you get an extra $50,000 on top of it. That's the premium, an additional gain. Bonds usually have interest paid semi-annually, okay? They might be paid once, just annually. It's possible, usually semi-annually, twice a year, every 6 months, but you have to read the questions carefully. So what we're going to have to do is determine the number of periods in the life of the bond. So you take the number of periods, you take the life of the bond in years, multiply it by the number of periods, and that's going to give you the total number of periods. You multiply it by two, and that's going to give you the total number of periods, right? So if it's a five-year bond, paid semi-annually, what's going to happen? You're basically going to multiply the 5 years times two and get 10 periods. Okay. Now we're going to need to calculate for semi-annual interest payments something known as the periodic market rate. Now we know what the market rate is, the overall return if you invest in the market. All you have to do is take the market rate and divide by two if the interest payments are made twice a year, if they are semi-annual. And that gives you what we call the periodic market rate. We do the same thing for the coupon rate. We know if it's an 8% bond, but it's being paid interest twice, you have to take that coupon rate of 8% and divide it by two, and you get a 4% periodic coupon rate. And I'm going to do examples with you. I just want to give you the key points that you need to understand so we can move forward. All right. So let's do it now. Let's jump into and talk about issuing bonds. In these next few slides, I want you to understand the math behind issuing bonds when the market rate equals a coupon rate. Okay. And then we have to understand how to discount future cash flow to present value. See that little PVFCF? That's what I like to use. It's present value of future cash flows. We have to learn, how do I determine the present value of future cash flows, right? Really simple stuff. So we're going to do that. And then I'm going to go over the journal entries for you, okay? So let's jump right into this. When you get a question on bonds, usually the first question that they're going to ask or that you have to solve for, what's a bond selling price? All right, so this is what I want you to know. How do I calculate the bond selling price? There's two calculations we need to make. The first thing we have to do is take the present value of the future principal payment. In other words, if I have $1 million bond due in 5 years, well, I have to pay $1 million in 5 years, but that $1 million in 5 years is worth less today. So I have to do this calculation first. I have to determine what is the present value of the principal that has to be repaid at maturity. Then I have to add to it the present value of all those interest payments I have to make. Let's say I have to make, you know, $10,000 interest payments every 6 months. Well, $10,000 every 6 months is $20,000 a year, and times 5 years might be $100,000. But that's what it is in total, but that's a future value. I have to discount these periodic interest payments to present value to know how much to sell the bond for today. So that's the second calculation, all right? And we're going to use the coupon payments to help us do that. So first objective, calculate the bond selling price. So I have to come up with these two calculations. And in order to do that, I'm going to need to use the market rate. Whenever we discount future value to present value, I'm going to say this about 1,000 times tonight. We use the market rate, okay? And you're going to see that. So let's do an example. Here are the facts. It says Becker Corporation issued 6% $1 million bond. So 6% is the coupon rate. We have $1 million bond due in 4 years. All right. Now they tell us they're issued January 1st. Watch your dates. Dates are key. Is it February 1st, March 1st, April 15th? You have to pay attention to dates. Quite often, they'll give you like a January 1st or a July 1st, and they'll make it nice and easy and clean for you. We're going to use January 1st for the most of the examples throughout the evening, just because we have to first learn the basics before we could get into the advanced calculations and journal entries. All right. Now, they also tell us interest payments due twice a year, June 30th, December 31st. So that means this is semi-annual. So we're making two payments every year for 4 years. So two payments times 4 years is 8 periods. Easy. Then they tell us the yield or the market rate, 6%. And you say, wait, Mike, what was the coupon rate? 6%, market rate, 6%. Big smile, right? Big smile for you. You know why? Because this is the easiest example there is. I showed my kids this example. They saw this emoji smiling like that. And they were like, Dad, that emoji looks just like you. I was like, what? I smile a lot. That doesn't look like me. It was the nice kids I have, right? Those are my kids. Thanks. When I get old, they're the ones who are going to take care of me, right? Okay, forget my kids and forget my emoji head. So now here's a required question. Determine the selling price of the bond. That's the first thing we have to do. Then they want to prepare the journal entries for both the borrower, person issuing the bonds, and the investor, the person purchasing the bonds at issuance. So we're not worrying about in the future. I'm just worried about today, January 1st, you bought the bond. What is the price you pay? And then what are the journal entries? Okay. So we know both the market rate and coupon rate are 6%. Therefore, we're selling it at face value. We're selling it at par. Okay. Easiest thing in the world. No math is needed. So you know what? I know the answer to the selling price, $1 million. That's it. You go, Mike, how'd you do that so fast? Because if the market rate equals a coupon rate, you always sell at par, $1 million. Easy. All right. If you get that in a multiple choice questions, snap your fingers, fill in the dot, click the little thing on the screen. I say fill in the dots. I used to do it all on paper, right? Click the screen and you're ready to go. Okay. Now, for now, let's just say I'm going to walk you through the math so you see why really is $1 million. We have a present value table here. Okay. Present value of $1. So I want you to have a few little notes on the present value of $1. We're going to need this table for calculation one, when we need to figure out the present value of the future principal payment. Because what happens is anytime we have to make a future one-time lump sum payment, we use the present value of a dollar. $1, one payment. Nice and simple, okay? So what we have to do is we have to discount this future lump sum we have to pay, $1 million in the future, to present value today. And we're going to use this table to do that. Then we have another present value table, and they could give you these in the exhibits. And that's why I want to make sure you understand how to use them. Present value of an annuity of $1. So when we talk about an annuity, We're going to use this for calculation too, because what we're doing here is we have to determine the present value of future periodic uniform interest payments. So we're going to make the same interest payment every 6 months, every period. That's the definition of an annuity. Same payment, regular course of time, regular intervals. Now, what we're doing is take these multiple payments and make one discount to present value. And we're going to take calculation one, the present value of the future lump sum payment, add it to calculation two, the present value of the future multiple interest payments, and figure out the selling price. Now, whenever we say the present value of an annuity of $1, they can also say an ordinary annuity. That's okay. That means you're making payment at the end of the period. And that's what we're doing in bonds. There's another type of annuity they could try to distract you with called an annuity due. And an annuity due is when the payment is made at the beginning of the period, not at the end of the period. Now, some type of, functions in finance need an annuity due, but not our bonds. With bonds, we generally do not use the annuity due. We use the ordinary annuity or just present value of an annuity of $1. So just watch out for the annuity due. We generally do not use that. All right. Now, here are some steps that we're going to go through. And this is great because we could use these same steps for everything. Issued at par, issued at a discount, issued at a premium. So this is why I like to do these deep dives. So I give you steps to memorize. And once you know these steps, it's so simple. First thing you're going to do is calculate the number of payments, which we already did. It's going to be a number of periods. It's going to be 8 periods, right? We're going to calculate the periodic market rate. We're going to calculate the periodic coupon rate. And then we're going to calculate our interest payment. All right. Those are the first 4 things that we do. Takes you about 10 seconds to do that. Really simple math. Then all the work comes in step 5 and step 6. Step 5, we have to calculate the present value of the principal payment. And step 6, we calculate the present value of the interest payments. These are the 6 steps you need to know for bond issuance. And we're going to use it for everything, par, discount, or premium. All right? So let's see how this works. Step 1, how many periods are in this problem? 4 years times semi-annual payments, 2 payments a year. 4 years times 2 payments a year, 8 periods. All right, let's keep track of this. Lower right-hand corner, lower left-hand corner on your screen, I'm going to start to make some notes. We have periods 8. Second step, calculating the periodic market rate. Now, the periodic market rate is you take your annual interest rate for the market and you divide it by the number of periods here, 2 per year. So it's going to be 6% market rate divided by 2 periods a year gives us 3% periodic market rate. So we need to keep track of that, all right? We need that number. Once we have that, we're going to go to step 3. Step 3 is a periodic coupon rate. Now, the coupon rate in this case happens to be the same as the market rate. It's not always that way. But again, you take your coupon rate and you divide it by 2 payments a year. We divide it by 2 for semi-annual interest, and you get 6% divided by 2, another 3%. So now we have the number of periods, the periodic market rate, the periodic coupon rate. 4 is really easy now. Now calculate your interest payment. Every period, what's your interest payment? All you do is you take your par value of the bonds and you multiply it by the periodic coupon rate. Remember, the coupon rate is used to calculate the interest. So we know it's $1 million in bonds, they told us, and we know the periodic corporate rate is 3%. So the interest payment is going to be $30,000 every 6 months. So let's keep track of that. So now we know steps 1 through 4, and we need these in order to move on to step 5 and step 6. So I'm going to kind of clear my slide right now, but I'm going to leave what we just solved for at the bottom of the slide so we have these numbers. Okay, so now we're going to continue with step number 5. We know in 4 years, we have to pay back $1 million, right? 4 years from today, January 1st, I have to pay back $1 million. So what we're going to do is use the present value factors to determine what is that $1 million worth today, all right? So I'm going to say it again, and I'm going to say it a lot of times. We do not use the coupon rate to determine what our present value factors are, all right? We must always use the periodic market rate, okay? Anytime we're going to figure out what present value factors we need, you use the market rate, the periodic market rate, not the coupon rate. Star it, memorize it, make sure you know it. That, my friends, is key. So here's a formula to calculate the present value of the future principal payment. You take the par value of $1 million and you multiply it by the present value factor. But the question is, what is this present value factor? How do I get it from this table? Well, you need two things. You need the number of periods. And notice we already calculated the number of periods in step one. Oh, it's 8. So you know what I do? I go to my present value table and I look for N equals 8. And there it is. That's the first thing that I need. Second thing that I need is the periodic market rate. Periodic market rate is 3%. So once I know N is 8 and my periodic market rate is 3, I find the intersection and I get 0.7894. Now keep this in mind. A lot of times, I just use 4 decimal places here. Sometimes they'll give you 6 decimal places, 8 decimals. They'll give you the number of decimals you need so that there's no rounding issues, okay? So if you were to make an amortization table with only 4 digits, you'd be off by a couple of dollars. But again, don't worry about that. On the exam, you don't have to worry about it. Oh my God, am I going to get it wrong because I rounded? No, they'll give you the number of digits you need to come up with the right answers for these, okay? All right, so here's my formula. My present value is going to be, of the principal, is going to be $1 million times my present value factor I just found in the table, 0.7894. I do the math and I get $789,400, and that's calculation one. So remember, I'm trying to figure out the bond selling price. He said, but Mike, I thought it's $1 million. It is $1 million. I'm just showing you why it's $1 million, but we're doing it for par value, which on the exam you don't need to do, but we're going to need the same logic to figure out the selling price when we sell at a discount and when we sell at a premium, okay? So stay with me here. All right, so we have calculation one. Now let's go to the last step, step six, and figure out the present value of the future periodic interest payments. So in this case, what we're doing is we have 8 interest payments of $30,000 each, okay? That's 8 times 30 is $240,000, right? So I'm going to pay, yeah, $240,000, but that's in the future. That $240,000 is not worth $240,000 today, okay? So what's it worth today? So we have to figure that out by taking $30,000 times the present value factor of an annuity. So now here's my annuity table. So what I have to do, find my number of periods, which we already did is 8. So I go to row 8 in this table. You see, I highlighted it in yellow. Then I get my periodic market rate. Same thing. Same thing we just did in step 5, 3%. I find the intersection between the two and I get 7.020. So I take that, I plug it in. 30,000 times 7.020 gives me 210,600. So though, yes, in the future, I'm paying 240,000, it's only really worth today $210,600. All right. So that's my calculation two. So if you remember from step 5, we had calculation one. Now in step 6, we have calculation two. Add it all up and bingo, what's my bond selling price? $1 million. I told you this is the simplest situation. When the market rate equals a coupon rate, the selling price equals par value, no math is needed. But now you see why. And the reason I also showed it to you on the exam in a test-based simulation, the par value might equal the coupon value, but they might ask you to go through the calculations and they might ask you to determine, you know, what's the apportionment to principal? What's the apportionment to periodic payment? So you don't know what they're going to ask you. So that's why it's good to understand the math. Okay. All right. That was super easy one. Now, here's what happened. We issued, we sold $1 million bond, right? We know we have to pay $30,000 in interest every 6 months. So we got cash in of $1 million. We're going to spend cash out of $30,000. And here they are, 6 payments. June 30th, year one, December 2, year 3, year 3, year 4, year 4. So in total, you see all these 8 interest payments are $240,000 we're putting out of pocket. But because that's a future value, we calculated the present value is only $210,600. Same thing. We know on December 31st, year 4, we have to pay the entire $1 million principal back. But present value of that $1 million is only $789,400. And if I add those two up, even though we cashed out of our pocket $1.24 million over the 4 years, today, the present value is only $1 million, and that's why we sell the bonds for $1 million. All right. Okay. Journal entry for this transaction of the bond on the date of issuance. Let's first do it from the borrower, the person issuing the bonds. Well, they're going to receive cash, right? So we debit the cash because we're increasing our asset. Then we're creating this liability, $1 million, right? So now we have to pay that $1 million back in 4 years. All right. So we always check. Now we know the accounting equation. I'm not going to write it out every time, but we know assets must equal liabilities plus equity. And every time we have our journal entries, we have to make sure this balances, because if it doesn't balance, we did something wrong. All right. So this is an easy one, right? Asset goes up a million, liability goes up a million. No big deal. What about on the bondholder side, the person, the investor purchasing the bonds? Well, they now have a new asset, $1 million in investment in bonds on their balance sheet, right? But they had to spend $1 million to get those bonds, right? So asset goes up a million, another asset goes down a million. So they're in balance as well, all right? So super simple journal entries for this transaction, okay? All right, we're moving along. This is not bad stuff. We're going to get to the heavier stuff soon, but it's coming. Give me some time, okay? So just last thing I want you to keep in mind. You see in year one, we paid two interest payments of $30,000 in year one, right? So that was $60,000 in annual interest that we paid. That was the actual interest payment. Now, the market rate equaled the coupon rate in this example. That's why we sold at par, at face value. So anytime that's the case, the interest expense that you're allowed to put on your income statement is always going to equal the interest payment. They're the same, the interest expense and the interest payment. They're always the same when you sell at par. This, my friends, is not going to be true when we deal with premiums and discounts, okay? With premiums and discounts, it means the market rate does not equal the coupon rate. So that means the annual interest expense will not equal the annual interest payment. And you're going to see that with a number of examples, all right? Okay, so now we're going to move along to issuing bonds when the market rate is greater than the coupon rate. So this is going to be selling bonds at a discount. All right, so we're going to look at the bond issuance journal entries for this. All right, so the same example, Becker Corp issues 6% of bonds. So that's our coupon rate, $1 million due in 4 years. That's the same as last example, issued January 1st, two payments, right? June 30th, December 1st, all the same. All right, now, yield or my market rate is 8%. You go, what? Oh no, my market rate is greater than my coupon rate. Now, I think I look more like that guy with the glasses on than the first emoji, but either way, you know, it's always good to be compared to a supermodel. Like these emojis, they're like, everybody knows the emojis, right? It's always good to be compared to an emoji. All right, so market rate is compared to the coupon rate. Is greater than the coupon rate. Anytime that happens, people want to invest in the market. They don't want to invest in your coupon. So here's a question. Here's what's required. What's the selling price of the bond? Prepare the journal entry. Same question again as the last one. Do this at issuance. So same exact question. The only difference between this example and the last example is the market rate. All right. Went from 6% to 8%. So now the market rate of 8 is greater than the coupon rate of 6. Therefore, we have to sell these for less than par. We have to put them on sale. We have to sell them at a discount. Otherwise, no one's going to buy our bonds because they'd rather invest in the market because that's 8% and our bonds are only 6%. So we sell them at a discount. So let's go through the steps. Step one, periods are the same. All right, let's keep track of it. Step two, we've already done last example, 8% divided by 2. Last example, the periodic market rate was 6% divided by 2 is 3. Now it's going to be 8% divided by 2, so it's 4. So the periodic market rate changed from last example was 3, this example is 4, but the periodic coupon rate is going to be the same. 6% divided by 2, 3%, same as last example. And the periodic interest payments, they're going to be the same. You know why? Because the coupon payment did not change from last example. So we take our $1 million par value times our 3% periodic coupon rate, and we get $30,000. So everything here is the same. You know what I'm going to do here? Let me get my little laser pointer. Everything is the same except this 4%. Last example was 3%, okay? All right. So now what do we have to do next? Step five, we're trying to figure out the bond selling price. So what we have to do is we have to determine the present value of the future future cash flow that we have to outlay to pay back the $1 million. So we're going to need to use the present value factors. So remember, when we determine the present value factor to use, we only use a periodic market rate, not the coupon rate. All right. Always use the periodic market rate. So what we're going to do is take our 8 periods. Let's go to our table to 8. Then we go to our periodic market rate. This time it's 4%. Last time it was 3%. This time it's 4%. So our present value factor, 0.7307. So we take the $1 million, multiply it by the 0.7307, and now we get a present value of that $1 million future payment, $730,700. That's calculation one. All right, the present value of the future principal payment. Now, I just wanted to bring this up for a second because if you've ever done multiple choice questions, if you've been studying, sometimes on the exam, they might not give you the present value table. Many times they do as an exhibit, but sometimes they may just list a bunch of present value factors the way I'm listed it here. And you look at that and you're like, how do I handle this one? It's so simple. This is even easier than the table. You know why? If they give you something like this, you look for the same two things, number of periods and the periodic market rate. So look at this first column I put a red box around. That's the interest rate. What do we use? The periodic market rate. What is it? 4%. So I only am concerned with lines that list 4%. Anything else? Cross them out. Cross them out. I can't use them. So I know it's one of these two lines that list 4%. Then I just have to look at the number of periods. So I go to this column. How many periods are there? 8. So anything that has a 4, I can cross out. So if you look, which line does not have an X through it? Yeah, this line right here. It's the only one. So whether they give you the present value table or whether they give you a list of present value factors like this, same thing. All you need to know, the number of periods and the periodic market rate, not the coupon rate, the market rate. Okay. All right. So you see, that's what we use. That one has like a lot more decimals than it. The one that I use is just rounded to 4 decimals, but same number. All right. Okay. So that was step 5. Now let's do step 6. Let's calculate the present value of these future interest payments that we have to make. So we know there are going to be 8 payments of $30,000 each, right? $240,000. But what's it worth today? We need to determine the present value factor. So we have 8 periods. So we go to our present value table, find the N equals 8. I know my periodic market rate is 4%. I find 4%. Find the intersection, and there we go, 6.733. So I take that number, I multiply my 30,000 times the 6.733, and I get $201,900. And that, my friends, is the answer to calculation 2. So how do I know the bond selling price? I take calculation 1, the present value of the future payment of $1 million is $730,700. I add the present value of the future interest payments, $201,990, add it up, and notice my bond selling price is under $1 million. That's because the market rate is greater than the coupon rate. So the selling price is going to be less than par. We're selling the bonds at a discount. But what I want you to notice is same exact steps. The same steps I use for calculating for market rate equals coupon rate is the same thing when market rate is greater than coupon rate. And when we do the next one for the premium, exact same steps. All right. So here's another example how they could list those present value factors, this time for an annuity, right? I'm making sure it doesn't say annuity due because I don't want annuity due. I want just this, present value of an annuity of a dollar or present value of an ordinary annuity. That's fine, but not an annuity due. So I have to find my interest payment and I'm looking for my periodic market rate of 4%, right? Same thing. So I only have 2 lines that have 4%. I can cross every other line out. I don't need them. Then I need to find the number of periods and I'm looking for 8 periods. I could cross out anything that's not 8 periods. What's the only line that doesn't have any X's in it? You got it. So I take this number and notice I use 6.733 because I only had 3 decimals in my table. This one has like 6 decimals, but it's the same number if you round it. All right. So just want to show you how to do that. Now what I'd like to do is summarize what happened. So this is the exact same thing we did before. $1 million we just received, right? Cash in. Now I have to pay 8 $30,000 payments over the next 4 years. So I have $240,000 going out over 4 years, but the present value of that today we calculated as $201,990. Then I know at the end of year 4 I have to pay $1 million in principal. But the present value of that payment today is only $730,700. So even though I'm putting $1.24 million out of my pocket, it really today is only $932,690. Okay, so that is the selling price. All right, that, my friends, is the selling price. It's being sold at a discount. So journal entries, almost like before, just a little different. Okay, because how much cash are we receiving this time? Not $1 million. We're selling them at a discount. We're only receiving $932,690. So we debit cash because that increases our cash. And then we have to pay back this bond of $1 million in 4 years. So we create this liability of $1 million. Problem is, doesn't add up, right? So now what we have is called a discount on the bond payable. Because we can't sell it for $1 million, we're putting it on sale. What's the sale price? It is a built-in loss, right? It's the plug for the built-in loss because we're paying back $1 million in 4 years, but we only got $932,000. So the difference between the million and the $932,000, that's $67,310. And what we call that is a contra liability. Contra means against, almost like opposite of a liability, because what's going to happen is that's a loss. It's a built-in loss. And with every interest payment, we're going to do something called amortizing that loss. In other words, matching principle, right? We can't just take the entire loss all at once. We've got to match it with the interest payments that we make. And every interest payment, we're going to take a bit of this contra liability, this $67,000, and we're going to recognize it at that point in time. And what it's going to do, it's going to take the carrying value of the bond, which is $932,000 and change, and it's going to slowly start to pull the carrying value up towards $1 million. Because when the last interest payment is made, that carrying value of the bond must be $1 million because that's what we're going to have to pay off. So by amortizing this built-in loss over time, it's going to help us pull up the value, the carrying value of the bond until it reaches $1 million at the end of the fourth year. Okay. All right. So think of this $67,310 as an unamortized discount that we will amortize over the course of the next 8 interest payments. Now, if we look at it from the investor, the bondholder side, they are only paying $932,690, right? So they have an investment in bonds, $932,690, right? So you debit that investment in the bond. So you increase your asset. And what happens? You have to pay cash, $932,690. So you're going to decrease your asset of cash. You credit your cash. So you'll notice all the journal entries balance out, all right? So what we have basically is making sure that no matter what, our assets is going to equal our liabilities plus our equity. And if you look at the first series of journal entries for the borrower, that contra liability moves in the opposite direction of an ordinary liability. All right. So it almost moves in that you could think of it as moving in the same direction, basically as an asset, because it is a contra liability. So what we're having is we're having the asset go up the 932 and then the 67 acts the same way. You could think of it as basically decreasing a liability or increasing an asset, and it's going to add up to $1 million to balance off that liability that you have for the bond payable. And obviously for the bondholder side, it's easy, right? One asset up, the other asset down, piece of cake. All right. Now let's talk about bond issuance when the market rate's less than the coupon rate and it's a premium. It's the exact same thing we just did, just opposite. In this time, market rate's less than the coupon rate. So we'll look at the issuance journal entries for that. So coupon rate, 6%, $1 million bonds, 4 years, issue January 1st, 2 payments, semi-annual. So now we know there are 8 periods. Here's the difference. Interest rate, 4%. So it went from originally the first example, 6%. Last example was 8%. So we had to sell it at a discount. This one is going down to 4%. It's going down to less than the market rate. Okay. So what is that? Oh, wait, hold on. Wake up. I got to hit my emoji. Wait, there you go. Hate when my emojis fall asleep during my lectures. All right. Hope no one else out there falling asleep. All right. All right. This is good stuff. You got to pay attention to this. So now this is the first time we're seeing a premium, right? Market rate is less than the coupon rate. All right. So what does that basically mean? We're going to sell it at a premium. They're going to ask, what's the selling price of the bond? Prepare the journal entries at issuance. Same thing we've done. So we know now, because the market rate's only 4%, but the coupon rate 6%, people are going to say, I'd rather buy your bond for 6%. Why am I going to invest in the market and only get 4% return when I can buy your coupon and your bond and get 6%, right? I say, oh, you want my bond that bad? Guess what? I'm going to charge you a little extra for it because it's in demand, right? People want it. So anytime that happens, we can sell it for greater than par. We sell it at a premium, all right? So let's go through our steps. We know there are 8 periods. Let's track that. We know the periodic market rate is the market rate, in this case, 4% divided by 2 or 2%. So this is the first time we've had the periodic market rate this low, 2%. Then we have the periodic coupon rate. That's the same, 6% divided by 3. That is unchanged from all of our other examples. So that means our interest payment is unchanged because our interest payment's the par value times the coupon rate. So a million times the 3% is the same $30,000 we've been using the whole time. So I went fast through those four steps because we've done them numerous times already. Nothing's changed yet other than the market rate changing a little bit. Okay, now let's get into step 5, determining the present value of that future $1 million that we have to pay back. So in that situation, we need a present value factor. What do we need for the present value factor? Not the coupon rate, right? How many times do I have to say it? Not the coupon rate. What do we need? The periodic market rate. So I need to know the number of periods and the periodic market rate to determine my present value factor. So we know we have 8 periods. So I go to my table, I find N equals 8. I go to my periodic market rate, it's 2%. I go to 2% and I get 0.8535. So to calculate the present value of that $1 million future payment, I take the $1 million, I multiply it by my present value factor, and I get $853,500. So that, my friends, that is calculation one. That's the present value of that future $1 million payment in 4 years. Now, what about step 6? Step 6, we need to calculate the present value of all these future interest payments, right? And we know how many there are. 8 payments at $30,000 each. That has not changed in any of my examples. So what we're going to do is take that $30,000 interest payment and multiply it by the present value factor of an ordinary annuity or just an annuity. So we know we have 8 periods. So I go to my table. I look for 8. I look for my periodic market rate. That's 2%. I find the intersection of those two. And I get 7.326. So what do I do in that situation? I take my $30,000 interest payment, I multiply it by the present value factor that I found in the table, and I get $219,780. And that, my friends, is calculation two. So now I'm ready to determine the selling price of the bond. I take calculation one, the $853,500. I take calculation two, the $219,780, add them together, and I get a bond selling price of, oh my goodness, over $1 million. That selling price is more than $1 million. Yeah. You know why? Because the market rate was less than the coupon rate. So people wanted my coupon. It was in demand. I could sell it for more money. The selling price is greater than par. All right. It means we sold the bond at a premium. Okay. All right. Now, summarizing what happened, same as everything else. Right? This is all the same as everything else. The only difference is going to be the sale price at this point. Present value of that those interest payments was $219,780. Present value of that $1 million future lump sum payable is $853,500. So you add it all up, and that $1.24 million today is only worth $1,073,280. So now when I go to my journal entries for a premium, the way it works, we're now receiving not $1 million cash, we're receiving $1,073,000 and change. So what are we doing? We're debiting our asset to increase the cash we received, but we have to pay back only $1 million. So, hey, this is pretty good. I like this math. I received $1,073,000, but I only have to pay $1 million back? Awesome. Well, what happens to that other $73,280? Well, I have an asset that I just received the cash. I have a liability that I have to pay off. So now I have my plug. Right? So what's happening here, this is a built-in gain. With the discount, it's a built-in loss. But with you sell on a premium, it's a built-in gain. So what do? We're going to credit this bond, premium on bond payable for the difference between the two, all right? So what we're going to do over time is recognize this gain with each interest payment. But because of the matching principle, we cannot just recognize it all right now at $73,280. We have to do it in pieces. We have to amortize it with each interest payment. So if we do our math, we have an increase in asset of $1,073,000. We have increase in liabilities of $1,073,000. Everything balances out on our equation in our journal entries. So the same way we saw with the discount, we have the same thing here, but it's not an unamortized discount. It's an unamortized premium. And what happens is every time we amortize it, we need to pull the face value, the carrying value down from $1,073,000 all the way down to $1 million so that at maturity, the carrying value is $1 million. So with discounts, it was $39,000 or something like that. We have to pull the value up to $1 million. With premiums, when you sell bonds at a premium, you amortize and pull the carrying value down to $1 million. And we'll do those examples in just a minute. All right. So here is the bondholder side. We have investment in bonds, $1,073,000. So that's an increase in an asset. And of course, they had to pay cash. So we credit the cash, same amount. So one asset up, one asset down, same amount. We are in unison. All right. We're in balance. That's good. All right. So that's everything on selling bonds at par, selling bonds at a discount, and selling bonds at a premium. Real fast, I just want to talk about something known as bond issuance costs. I want you to know what they are and how we account for bond issuance costs, all right? All they are transactional fees that we might be responsible for when issuing a bond. Now, in the real world, they're always there, but on the AI CPA exam, they don't always have you include them, all right? So you have to read closely. In this example, are there bond issuance costs or are there not bond issuance costs? They may say ignore bond issuance costs, so you have to read carefully, okay? What are some examples? Legal fees, accounting fees, underwriting fees, printing fees, all considered bond issuance costs. Now, you can account for these two different ways when they give you bond issuance costs. The first way is the easiest way. You basically pay them when the bonds are issued, all right? And you account for them when the bonds are issued. That's the easiest way. But they may tell you that rather than paying them when the bonds are issued, you know what? You need to pay them beforehand, a month or a quarter beforehand. And then you pay them first before you issue the bonds, and you have to defer the cost on your balance sheet until the liability is recorded. So it's going to create an asset for us on our balance sheet because we have this deferred expense, all right? So I'm going to show you how that works. Okay, let's take a look at the discount example we did. So example number two I did you, that was a discount. Remember, the coupon rate was 6%. Bond is $1 million, due in 4 years, issued January 1st. Two payments, June 30th and December 31st. Market rate is 8%, which is greater than the coupon rate. Therefore, we're going to sell it for a discount. Now, here's a new fact I just added. See that box in yellow? They tell you bond issuance costs are $30 and they were incurred, all right? So bond issuance costs of $30,000 were incurred. All right, now they don't tell you that the bond issuance costs were paid ahead of time. So they just tell you, oh yeah, there were $30,000 bond issuance costs. All right, I'm gonna account for those when I issue the bonds. So I know the market rate of 8 is greater than the coupon rate of 6, so I'm gonna sell these bonds at a discount. We already did that. All right, so they want the journal entries. Well, here were the journal entries. We already did this. This is when there were no bond issuance costs, all right? I already showed you these journal entries. I don't need to repeat it. It's the exact same thing we did in example two. What I want to show you now is the difference. So what was the present value of that future interest? If you remember, it was $201,990, and the present value of that future principal payment was $730,700. We already calculated that in example two, and that's how we came with the discount price of $932,690. And that's why we put this as the cash received, okay? The bonds were sold at a discount for $932,690. That's when there were no issuance costs. Now with the issuance costs, here's what we need to do. We need to take those issuance costs and subtract them from the cash received, because really we're saying, all right, I'm getting 932, but right away 30,000 is going somewhere else. I don't even get to touch it. I don't get to keep it. So the present value now is going to be 902,690. We've removed that $30,000. So here's what the journal entries look like with the bond issuance cost included. All right. We're now, yeah, we're receiving 932, but 30,000 is going away. So we're really only putting 902,690 into our bank account. So we debit the cash of the 902, not the additional 30,000 we're using for issuance costs. Okay. So that's the big difference right now. So we're increasing our asset here. And now we know we have this payable, this liability of $1 million, right? That's easy. We know that. What about this discount on bond payable? That's the plug figure, right? That's the loss. For selling at a premium, it's going to be the built-in loss. Now it's $97,310. So where did that come from, this contra liability we called it? It comes from the discount as if there were no bond issuance costs, $67,310, but we have to add the bond issuance costs to that, all right? So that's how we come up with this plug, this built-in loss of the $97,310, all right? Now here from the bondholder side, take a look at it. There's nothing changed. So from the bondholder side, they don't even worry about the bond issuance costs, all right? We only have to account for that a little differently when we're dealing with the issuer, not when we're dealing with the holder, all right? So that's the first example. Now, on the left side of my screen, you see what I just did with you. This was originally the journal entries on the right side of the screen. I just slid them over to the left. These are the journal entries we just did with the bond issuance costs included, where we took care of them upon issuance of the bond. What I want you to do is look at the example right now and notice I added a little more text to it in blue. So we have bond issuance costs of $30,000 were incurred, and now it says, and due 1 month before the January 1st issuance date. 1 month before that is December 1st of the prior year. So, I have to now include a separate set of journal entries because I'm going to pay them a month ahead of time, okay? So here's what we would have to do if the bond issuance costs are paid ahead of time, before bond issuance, all right? On the date when these costs are incurred on the December 1st, 1 month beforehand, I have to pay this $30,000, right? But we have these deferred bond issuance costs. So I'm going to have this like basically something I cannot expense until I issue the bonds on January 1st. So I'm crediting cash $30,000 because I'm spending $30,000 out of my pocket, right? $30,000 comes out of my bank account and it goes towards these bond issuance fees. But I can't expense them yet. I have to defer them for a month until January 1st. So that's why we debit the deferred bond issuance cost. So we have this asset living on our balance sheet that we could expense on January 1st when we issue the bonds, okay? So one asset up $30,000, one asset down $30,000, we are in balance. Now, anytime we have the prepaids, that's how we handle it, right? Nice and easy, like any other prepaid. Now we go to January 1st, a month later. So what do we do here? Well, now on January 1st, we issue the bonds. We get the $932,000 cash, right? So we debit the cash because we just received that cash. That's going to increase an asset. We have this discount and bond issuance cost plug, the $97,310, right? That's our contra liability. And we have the bond payable of $1 million. So almost looks the same right now, but if you add it up, it doesn't add up. We're missing one other figure, okay? We need these deferred bond issuance costs of $30,000. We need to now get them off our balance sheet because we can expense them now. So we're going to now move them to an expense on our income statement. They're no longer deferred. So this is basically going to reverse what we did prior, all right? So now if we take a look at it, everything is going to be in balance at this point. So what we've done is we've taken, if we had these bond issuance costs and we were able to account for them when the bonds were issued on the left, the way we did the very first time, it would just be the one set of journal entries. But now if they tell us that the bond issuance costs have to be paid ahead of time, we have to break it down into two separate sets of journal entries, okay? So that's the difference between this problem. If you look at the bottom left corner, the investor, the bondholder, those journal entries remain unchanged. Whether it was going to be bond issuance costs included or bond issuance costs prepaid ahead of time, a month ahead of time, it does not affect the investor, the bondholder. Those are the same. Okay. All right. So we're basically at the halfway mark right here, about an hour. My friend Josh, how are you, my friend? We have any questions we need to address now that we've gone through bond issuance? Anything at all?
Now, everything looks good, Mike. Just some content questions originally about zero coupon rate versus market rate, frequency of payment, and the types of accounts that we're seeing in terms of discount and premium and that sort of thing. But TAs are all handling
Josh,
everything.
You know the answers to these questions, or do you phone a friend?
I phone a friend all the time, but amongst Karen, Deb, and me, yeah, we're good.
ChatGPT gave you the right answers, you think?
I don't even know how to use ChatGPT.
All right. Hey, everybody, this is what we're going to do. I have 2 minutes after the hour. I'm literally coming back in 4 minutes, like 6 minutes after the hour. So if you need to stretch out, get a glass of water, go do that, and we'll be back 4 minutes, okay? 4 minutes. All right, my friends, who is having fun, right? He said, oh my God, I was always so intimidated about bonds, but bonds are not that bad. And guess what? All those other subjects in FAR or any other exam that intimidate you, they're not that bad. And that's why we're putting these deep dives together. Because listen, we know some people get stuff faster than others. Some people have different work experience. Some have different professors in schools that teach things better. Not everyone's in the same boat. Some people could just use our regular course and no problem. They get through it. We actually, I know grades were supposed to come out on June 4th for people. Then they said they're coming out, but just said today they're coming out tomorrow. They actually released some grades today. We had somebody that contacted me, believe it or not, passed all four parts in one quarter. This first quarter passed all four parts. I don't know how. I would never be able to do something like that. But hey, this stuff works. If you follow what we ask you to do and you follow our plan and you listen to the way that we teach it, you could do this and you can definitely pass. Whether FAR is giving you a hard time, bonds, consolidations, journal entries, whatever it is, financial statements, you can do this. You just have to follow the plan, do the home, watch some videos, do the homework, do the multiple choice, the task-based simulations, do the mini exams, do the practice exams, do your simulated exams. But when you do exams, you have to review them. Make some notes. What I did, every time I got a question wrong, I had an Excel spreadsheet and I would have like a FAR spreadsheet. I'd have unit one, unit two, unit three, unit four at the bottom. And I would keep track of everything that I got wrong on those little sheets. And then every night or every couple of nights, I'd read through what I got wrong. So I read through these things 30 times. By the time I sat for the real exam, I knew the stuff I was getting wrong better than the other stuff that I knew. So there's a method to the madness. And we put nothing but effort and quality into our program and into our material. And we've had great results with the last score release, what the score releases we're getting right now. The program works and it works well. And we've been around forever. But let me tell you something. All we do is put more back into our program. Brand new videos, everything CPA Evolution. It is everything that you need to pass this exam and pass it now. Do it right. Do it once and get those three beautiful letters after your name. And you'll be so happy that you did it. All right. So I am now on to the second part of this. We learned everything there is about bond issuance. Now we have to talk about once it's issued the bond, and we start making interest payments over time, what are the journal entries there? And what is this thing called amortization, right? That's what we have to talk about now. So in this next topic, we want to understand journal entries after issuance when market rate equals a coupon rate, the easy one when the bonds are issued at par. And I already told you this, the interest payment is going to equal the interest expense. Only when the market rate equals a coupon rate. That's the only time, okay? We do not need to amortize here, all right? No amortization needed when market rate equals the coupon rate, all right? Make sure you know that. So same problem we've been dealing with, 6% coupon rate, 8 periods, 6% market rate. So since the market rate of 6% equals a coupon rate of 6%, bonds are going to be sold at par. So we already calculated in the last time we did this example, the periodic market rate is 6% divided by 2 or 3%. Periodic coupon rate is also 3%. Now, here's a little table that I'm going to create. And you say, hey, Mike, this looks like an amortization table. And I thought we didn't need to amortize. Well, we don't. And I just want to show you why that is. So when we make our first interest payment, because what this question is now asking us to do, it's asking us basically to, you'll see I highlighted in yellow, prepare the journal entries for the first interest payment. So that's what we want to do. Let's look at the interest payments. All right. So notice the interest payment we are going to make, $30,000. Remember how we got that? The $1 million times the 3% is $30,000. That didn't change. It's also going to be the same as the interest expense. Why? Because market rate equals coupon rate. No math is needed here. It's very simple. Okay, so make sure you know that. And notice the second interest payment and the third interest payment and the fourth interest payment and all the interest payments. It's the exact same thing. There's no amortization. The interest payment is always $30,000. The interest expense is always $30,000. All right, nice and easy. So I'm going to just kind of shrink this table a little bit. Same table, I just shrunk it so that we can see it. And notice what's happening there. The carrying value of the bond is always $1 million, right? Never changes. When the market rate does not equal the coupon rate, we sell at a premium or at a discount, carrying value changes. And we're going to see a lot of these other numbers change as well. We'll get to that in just a minute, okay? Now, here's our journal entry we've already done. So we've done this. This is at issuance. Okay. This was the journal entry at issue, right? We receive $1 million and we have a payable of $1 million, right? And the bondholder, they have an investment of $1 million and they had to pay $1 million. So everything balances nice and easy. We saw this, no big deal. What I want to look at now when we sell at par is the journal entries for the first payment on June 30th, the first interest payment. So from the borrower's perspective, what do we have to do? We have to debit the bond interest expense. So that's going to be $30,000, right? That's our interest payment, which is also our interest expense. And what happens anytime an expense goes up? Well, as your expenses go up, your net income goes down. And if your net income goes down, you're going to have less retained earnings. So your equity goes down, right? So that's going to decrease our equity. Then what do we credit? We credit the cash of the $30,000. So that's an asset going down. So are we in balance? Of course we're in balance, because one side the asset goes down $30,000, the other side the equity goes down $30,000. So not a big deal. Now, when we look at it from the investor, from the bondholder perspective, here they're going to debit the cash because they're now receiving the interest payment. So they're receiving $30,000. So that's going to increase their bank account, right? The asset goes up. But what are they going to credit? The bond interest revenue, okay? So now at this point, as they could recognize the revenue, well, that means they're going to have greater net income, retained earnings, and greater equity. So our asset goes up $30,000 and the equity goes up $30,000. So we're in balance, all right? And that's easy. And guess what? You do the identical journal entry 7 more times. The only difference is you change the date. It goes from June 30th, year one, to December 31st, year one. June 30th, year two, to December 31st, year two. Same thing, just the date changes, right? That is my emoji friend. That makes him happy. He loves the easy way out. Anytime there's a par value, right? Coupon rate equals market rate. This guy shows his crazy bald head. All right. No bald jokes, please. Very, very sensitive, as you can tell. All right. Let's take a look at all the other journal entries now. So top left was the issuance. We saw this. Top right was the first interest payment. Now, let's fast forward to the end of 4 years. Let's say, okay, it's December 31st, year four. The bond has matured. What are the journal entries we need upon maturity? Well, December 31st, it says 27. I meant to put year four, but when I created my little amortization table or my little spreadsheets, instead of using year one, year two, year three, year four, I did year 24, 2024, 25, 26, 27. So if you're confused why it doesn't say year one, year two, year three, year four, I just put in 24, 25, 26, 27. All right. So our bond payable was $1 million, right? And we know we have to pay it out. And that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to pay $1 million. So we credit the cash $1 million, which is going to decrease our cash account by $1 million. The asset goes down. But now what do? We wipe the liability off the books, right? We get rid of the $1 million liability. So we're in balance. Asset down $1 million, liability down $1 million. All right, so that clears out the principal. But remember, the bondholder, what they have to do, they're receiving the $1 million cash. So they're increasing their asset. We debit their cash, and then we have to credit their investment in bonds because now they're taking the bonds off their balance sheet because now it's been repaid. Okay, so one asset up $1 million, one asset down $1 million. Now, there's also on that same date the last interest payment. And if you look at the interest payment in the bottom right for December 31st of the fourth year, it's exactly the same as the first series of journal entries on June 30th, right? Only difference is the date. That's it. Everything else is exactly the same. So these are all the journal entries you would need to know when you issue these bonds at par, from issuance all the way to maturity. All right. Not so bad. Not so bad. Now, all right, here we go. Here we go. Here we go. We're getting into bond amortization. All right. This is a big topic. This is where a lot of questions come from, especially if you're going to see it on a task-based simulation. You know you have to amortize, all right? You know you have to amortize. So let's go over why we amortize. Let's go over what an amortization period is. Let's talk about the two different amortization methods. And then finally, that will springboard us into an example using a discount, all right? Selling a bond at a discount, amortizing using the straight line method. Because we're going to have to amortize a discount using the straight line method, then a premium using the straight line method. Then we're going to have a discount using the effective interest method, then a premium using the effective interest method. So we have a bunch of examples to do. But once you do one, they all kind of seem the same, all right? As long as you know the basics. And remember what I told you at the beginning of class? I'm giving you a series of steps. And if you know these steps and you follow these steps, Come on, AI CPA. I dare you to give me this question. All right, let's do it. Okay, so anytime bonds are sold at a discount or a premium, we have to amortize them. Over what period of time? The life of the bond. That's it. Why do we do it? Because we have to spread out the gain or spread out the loss, matching principal, and match it up with each interest payment. All right, that's why we do it. Okay. And by doing it this way, it's going to help us with an accurate carrying value for our balance sheet, right? And it's also going to help us properly reflect the market value of these bonds. And that, my friends, leads to fair and accurate financial reporting, right? And that's what GAAP is all about. Fair and accurate financial reporting, making sure we're in regulatory compliance. Okay, so how do we determine what this amortization period is? Super simple. Take the bond maturity date minus the bond issuance date. That's it. Okay, that's it. Now, there's two different bond amortization methods. There's the super simple one, the straight line method. And then there's one that's a little more involved, not much. Okay, not much, but a little more involved, the effective interest method. Now, straight line method is not GAAP. You go, whoa, wait, hold on, Mike. Time out. What are you talking about, not GAAP? Everything on this exam, that's what they teach us in FAR, it's GAAP, right? Yeah, but, you know, they say, all right, listen, it might not be GAAP, but we'll let you do it if it's kind of close to the effective interest method. In other words, if you solve it with the straight line method and it's not too different from the effective interest method, we'll let you slide. We'll let you do it. And why would someone want to do it? Straight line method's easy. It's constant values for every period. It makes it so much easier. Effective interest method, we're going to see the values all change from one period to the next. So it's a little more work. Not much, but a little bit more. Okay? So the effective interest method, technically, this is GAAP. This is what you're supposed to do. But if straight line method's kind of in the ballpark, kind of close, they'll let you get away with it, all right? If it's not materially different. That's the phrase, not materially different. But there are two situations when straight line amortization is not allowed. When is that? Never use straight line amortization if you have long-term bonds, meaning they have a maturity date of 20 years or greater. Generally, you do not want to use, you cannot use straight line amortization. Or if you're dealing with zero coupon bonds, because there's no interest and the calculations are much different and it's materially different. So you can't do it. So just keep it in mind. If we're dealing with shorter bonds, you know, under 20-year maturity, or we're not dealing with zero coupon bonds, then we could probably get away with straight line method. But on the exam, they're going to probably tell you which method they want you to use, maybe both on a task-based simulation, who knows? But read carefully. Reading comprehension is key, okay? So let's start with straight line amortization because it's the easier one, all right? With straight line amortization, here are the steps you need to do, all right? First thing is you calculate the present value of the bond. Now, we've already done that. It's exactly what we did in the bond issuance. So I taught you how to do step one. No big deal. Step two, you have to calculate what's the present value of the discount or the premium. So to do that, all you have to do is take the par value minus the present value of the bond in step one. And I generally tell you, just take the absolute value of that. We don't care whether it's positive or negative. We care about here's the face value. If it's a discount, it's below. If it's a premium, it's above. And that's why one would come out positive, one would come out negative. We don't care. We just want to make sure we know, is it a premium or is it a discount? All right. And step number three, calculate the straight line amortization. All you do is you take that discount or premium amount and you divide it by the number of periods. And it's always going to be the same. For straight line amortization, that's going to be constant. So that's good. Then the fourth thing you do is have to calculate your interest payment. All right. Now your interest payment is the par value times a periodic coupon rate. That's exactly what we did in the bond issuance examples. No difference there, all right? Exactly the same. Then you have a constant interest expense as well, which is going to be your interest payment plus or minus your amortization amount, depending on whether we're dealing with a discount or a premium. And I'll show you how that works. Nice and easy, all right? Then from all the information we get from these steps, we can create an amortization table. I need you, when you do these at home and you do the practice and you do the task-based simulation, to have your little spread JS open or even use an Excel spreadsheet because they're virtually identical, and make sure you know how to create an amortization table, because you'll have a spreadsheet on the exam and it will make your life so much easier. All right. So let's walk through the steps. But before I do, a couple of last minute notes you have to be aware of. When the bonds are issued at a discount, the carrying value will start out below the par value, and you have to increase the carrying value till it hits par value at the very last interest payment, all right? The opposite is true when the bonds are sold at a premium. The sale price is above the par value, and you have to pull them down. You have to decrease the carrying value until it reaches a par value with the last payment, all right? Make sure you know that. Now, the amortization amount is going to be constant for the life of the bond. All right, the interest payment is going to be constant for the life of the bond. The interest expense is going to be constant for the life of the bond. And that's why straight line is so easy, because it doesn't change. It's the same every period. That's why we love it. All right. Okay. Then after that last interest payment is made, the bond carrying value must equal the bond par value. All right. So this is true regardless if you sell the bond at par, if you sell it for a discount, you sell it for a premium. This is always the case. All right. Now, let's go and do a little example. So it's the same example where we had the coupon rate 6, so our periodic rate is 3%, our periodic coupon rate, 2 payments over 4 years is 8 periods, and our periodic market rate is 8% divided by 2, or 4%. All right, so because we're at a periodic market rate of 8%, excuse me, a market rate of 8%, which is greater than the coupon rate of 6, we're selling at a discount. So from our first bond issuance example, remember we calculated the bond selling price, $932,690. I'm not going to redo those steps. We already did that in bond issuance. All right. That was step one. Now, step two, we take that $1 million par value, we subtract the sale price, and we get $67,310. That is the discount. All right. That is our discount that's going to need to be amortized. So now we have to calculate the straight line amortization. So we take that 67,310, we divide it by the number of periods, and we get $8,414. I put in the decimals there. Usually they'll tell you to round to the nearest dollar, but that's not going to change. All right. That's going to be constant. Then the interest payment is also going to be constant. It's going to be your par value tied to the periodic coupon rate. We did that numerous times for bond issuance. The $1 million times the 3% is the $30,000. And then finally, we have the constant interest expense, which is not the same as the interest payment. What we have to do is take the interest step from the interest payment from step four. And because we have to pull the carrying value up, right? Right now, the carrying value is below par. It's under a million. We have to pull it up towards par. So we have to add every time we amortize. We have to add that to the carrying value, all right? So the interest expense is going to be the interest payment plus the amortization. We get the $38,414. All right. Now we use all of these steps to create the amortization table. So let's do that. See these 5 steps? This is just what we did on the previous slide. I just squished it all up to the top just so you see it, but we did these calculations on the previous slide. All right, so here's our amortization table. With our first interest payment on June 30th, we know we're starting with the carrying value of 932. So here's our first interest payment, and here is our carrying value. That's our starting point. Now, do you see in step 3, this is where we calculated what the straight line amortization is, which is going to be constant, right? And we also know what the interest payment is. So what we have to do to calculate the interest expense is we basically have to take the amortization plus the interest payment, column C and D, and we add it up, and now we have column E. That is our interest expense. Okay, so that was the first one, the first payment. Now let's go 6 months into the future. Here's our second interest payment. What I need you to be aware of is the carrying value has changed. You notice it went from 932,000 to 941. How do we come up with that number? You take your carrying value, you add your amortization amount, and that pulls up the carrying value towards the par value. We have to pull it up towards $1 million, all right? And we do that with every payment, okay? And notice, these are all constant. The amortization amount, the interest payment, the interest expense for straight line doesn't change. All right. Does not change. That's why it's so easy. That's why we love it. All right. Here's a third payment. Notice you take the carrying value from the second payment, after the second interest payment, And then you add the amortization, and that gives you the carrying value for the third interest payment, right? And it just keeps working that way, all right? And again, these never change. They're always straight line. They're always the same. So if we fill this all the way down, here's what your entire amortization table would look like. So for straight line, this is super simple, and we love that. And look at that last bottom number. Remember I told you, once you reach maturity, once that last interest payment is made, that carrying value has to be face value. It has to be the par value. And then you pay it off with your one-time lump sum payment. That's how it works. All right, so what we're going to do at this point is we're now going to look at the journal entries to make sure we understand it. We've already done the bond issuance for this example. Let's now do the interest payments. So here was the bond issuance. So these first journal entries I put up, that's from last example. This was on January 1st, the day we issue the bond. These were the journal entries. Now, here are the journal entries for the first interest payment on June 30th. From the borrower's perspective, what we now have is a bond interest expense, all right, $38,413. And you see, we calculated that, right, the interest expense. So anytime we have an expense, what does that do? It's going to reduce our net income. And if it reduces our net income, our retained earnings are down, our equity is down, okay? That's how we think of the interest expense. But now we have to credit the discount on the bonds payable. This is where we amortize, right? This is the amortization piece. Remember, the straight line amortization is always 84.14, okay? That's always the case. So what we're doing is you see on the bond issuance journal entries, you see that $67,310? Every interest payment, we're taking that $8,414 and we're now basically amortizing that piece so that by the end of the eighth payment, we have now amortized the entire $67,300. So what we're doing here, it's our built-in loss. So we're decreasing that contra liability. And then, of course, we have to pay the $30,000. So we have to credit the cash, which basically is going to decrease our asset. So if we make sure we balance this all out, we have the decrease of the $30,000 on the asset side, then we have the decrease in equity. But when that contra liability goes down, it's in the opposite direction of a liability. So it's almost like a liability increasing. So we have equity going down $38,413, but then we have that contra liability going down, which is the same as a liability going up. They move in opposite directions. So they offset each other. So it's $38,413 less $8,413, which is $30,000. So on the liability plus equity side, we're down $30,000. On the asset side, we're down $30,000. So we're all in balance. Now, from the bondholder perspective, we have cash, right? So they're receiving a $30,000 interest payment, which was the cash paid by the bond issuer, right? So they're increasing their cash. So they debit the cash, $30,000. Now they have this investment in bonds, right? So they debit the investment in bonds because on their side, they're amortizing as well, right? It's in the opposite direction. So this is a gain for them. So it's our plug calculation for the gain. And then they have the bond interest revenue. All right. So this is, we had an expense on one side, on the issuer side, and then we have the revenue on the bondholder side. So if the revenue is up, the equity is up. Okay. So all that we're doing in this situation is we have an increase in equity of $38,000, and then we have the increase in the asset, and then we also have the gain. So it's also going to be an increase. So the $30,000 plus the $84,000 balances off with the $38,413 on the equity side. So everything is in balance. All right. Now, that was for a discount. Now what we need to do next is we need to do the same thing, but we're going to do it for a premium. And we're also going to do straight line. So it's the exact same problem. Periodic coupon rate is 3%, 8 periods. The only difference is here, the periodic rate. So you see, instead of being last example, it was 8%. So we had a 4% periodic market rate. Now we're at a 2% periodic market rate. So no one wants to invest in the market. They'd rather invest in our bonds. So that's the difference. So the market rate's less than the coupon rate. So we're going to sell at a premium. We already know what this was, the bond selling price from the bond issuance examples we did earlier, $1,073,000. That was step one. Same steps now, okay? Doesn't matter, discount or premium, same steps. What's the present value of the premium? You take the present value of the face value of the bonds, right? $1 million. We subtract the present value of the bonds, and now the premium is $73,280. Calculation three is the amortization amount. You take step two, the 73,000 divided by eight, and you have 9,160 as the amortization amount, and it's constant and never changes. Same thing for step number four, par value times a period. 1,000 never changes. Step five, constant, never changes. Interest expense is going to be step four, the 30,000 minus the 9,160 is the 20,840. And that is going to be our interest expense. Okay. So now that we do all of this super simple math, I'm going to go to the next slide. I'm going to push this all up to the top. So we have these calculations and I'm going to make the amortization table. Okay. All right, so here we are. Everything, all the calculations are at the top. Same amortization table. So we have the first interest payment, and we have our beginning carrying value, right? That's the present value of these future payments. So now we calculated the amortization amount, right? Whatever that premium was, a 73,000 divided by 8 gave us the 9,160. We know that the interest payment never changes, and now we have our interest expense, which is the cash paid less the premium. So the 30,000 less the 9,160 gives me my interest expense. So now how does this all work after that? So when we go to interest payment month number two, we have to get our new carrying value. So you take your beginning carrying value for the first interest payment, you subtract the amortization amount, and we're pulling down, okay? We're now pulling down the face value. Excuse me, we're pulling down the carrying value. It's at $1,073,000. It's going down to $1,064,000. And every payment is moving down, pulling down. The opposite of the discount. Remember the discount, we were pulling up towards $1,000,000. The premiums you have to pull down to $1,000,000 because with that last interest payment, you need the carrying value to be equal to the face value, the par value, $1,000,000. All right. And again, straight line, these columns never change. That's why straight line is so easy. So now interest payment three, take the carrying value after interest payment two, subtract the amortization, and that's going to give you your carrying value for the third interest payment. And we keep on going that way, all right? We go all the way down until you see with the very last payment, we pulled it down to $1,000,000. So at maturity, once we've gone through all the amortization, the carrying value must equal the par value. All right, so that's easy enough. Now let's take a look at the journal entries. On the left, you see the bond issuance journal entries. We've already done that. On the right side of the screen, we now have our first interest payment on June 30th. So let's do it from the borrower's perspective, the bond issuer. So they have an interest expense of $20,840. So anytime the expenses are up, it's going to lower our net income, less retained earnings. It's going to lower our equity. Now they have the premium on the bond payable, which we've already calculated as a straight line amortization, right? So that's never going to change. It's going to be how we amortize our gain. Remember when there was a sell at a discount, it's a loss for the bond issuer. The opposite is true for a premium. It's a gain, right? You're only going to pay back $1,000,000, but you got $1,073,000. So you had that $73,000 gain. So you see on the left, I have the double-headed arrow pointing on the left to the bond issuance, the $73,000. That was the unamortized premium. What we're doing is of that $73,280, we're now amortizing $9,160. So it's basically decreasing that liability by that amount. And then, of course, we credit cash because we had to pay $30,000 in interest. So that's going to decrease an asset. So if we look at all of that, we have our equity down 20,000. We have our liability down 9,000. You add those two numbers up, it comes out to 30,000, which balances with our decrease on the asset side of 30,000. So we're all in balance here as well. Everything is good. Now, if we look at it from the bondholder's perspective, we debit the cash 30,000 because they received the cash we just paid, right? Opposite. So they're increasing an asset by 30,000. Now their investment in bonds is where they're going to need to amortize their loss on this, right? Because they paid $1,073,000, but they're only getting $1,000,000 back. So they have a built-in loss of 73,000. So they're going to also amortize on their side when they credit the investment in the bonds of 9,160. And then they have the bond interest revenue of 20,840. So if we take a look at this, again, everything in balance at this point. We have one asset going up 30, the other one going down about 91.60, which is going to equal the increase in the equity. So ballpark equity, assets go up 20,840, equity goes up 20,840. All right. Now, bond amortization. What do we want to do in this one? We want to take a look at the last big topic we have, the effective interest method. All right. Super important. So stay with me. I know we're here over an hour and a half, just over an hour and a half, but we have just enough time to get done everything we need to get done. So let's learn about the effective interest method. Whoops. Sorry. Just hit the wrong button there. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to amortize a bond that was sold at a discount, but this time, instead of using straight line, we're going to do it with the effective interest method. And once we do it for the discount, we'll do it for the premium. So you see how it works. Okay. All right. Now I'm going to give you the steps necessary for the effective interest method. All right. Similar to straight line, but different. Okay. Definitely different. So I gave you steps for bond issuance. I gave you steps for straight line amortization, and now I'm giving you steps for effective interest method amortization. If you know those three series of steps, bond issuance, straight line amortization, effective interest amortization, you're going to rock any question they give you on bonds on the exam, you're going to hit a home run. No doubt about it. All right. No doubt. So let's take a look at it. We already know how to calculate the present value of the bonds. We already did that. Once we do that, calculate the present value of the discount or the premium. We did that in straight line. Easy enough. Now, step three, we have a variable interest expense. It is going to change with every interest payment. It is going to be the carrying value times the periodic interest rate. All right. That's how we calculate the interest expense. Interest payment is constant. This doesn't change. This is what we did before. Remember the $30,000, the par value times the periodic coupon rate. That doesn't change. But the amortization amount changes every single interest payment. And the way we get amortization is you take your interest expense less your interest payment, and the difference is going to be your amortization. All right. Then from these steps, we can create the amortization table. So we're going to do that once I explain a few more notes to you. We already talked about discount. This is a repeat. Yeah, you said, Mike, you taught me this. I know, but it's that important. We're going to do it again. When you sell bonds at a discount, the sale price is below the par value. So you need to increase, pull up the carrying value until it reaches par with each interest payment. Opposite is true when you issue bonds at a premium. The sale price is above the par value, so you have to pull it down. You have to decrease the carrying value with every interest payment. Now, this interest expense is going to be variable, and it's going to vary for the life of the bond. But the interest payment never changes. The interest payment is always constant for the life of the bond. Make sure you know that. These are easy things. If you get a quick little multiple choice question, these are little things. You go, oh, wait, hold on. Effective interest method, interest expense, it's never the same. It always varies. Or, oh, interest payment doesn't matter. It's always the same. Interest straight line, effective interest, always the same. Doesn't really make a difference. Premium, discount, always the same. Know these little notes, these clues, and they give you a point here, point there on your multiple choice. Believe me. Okay? All right. And remember, with that last interest payment, the carrying value has to equal the par value. All right. And I told you this earlier. This is a true statement. Whether you sell at a discount, whether you sell at a premium, whether you sell at par, doesn't matter. It's all true. It's always true. Okay. So here is our example. This time we're doing 3% coupon rate, 8 periods. Periodic market is 4%. But now look, see what I highlighted here? Before, under required, it said use the straight line method. This time it says use the effective interest method. All right. And then we're going to prepare the journal entries for the interest payment. So let's take a look at this. All right. Market rate's 8%, coupon rate 6%. So we know we're selling at a discount. We already know step one, that is the present value, the selling price of the bond, 932,690. We've already done that numerous times. Step two, we did this under straight line as well. Take the par value, subtract the present value of the bond, and that is your discount, 67,310. Here's what's new for effective interest method. What is your interest expense? It's your carrying value, 932,690. Times your periodic market rate, okay? And that's 4%. So we get 37,308. I could have done, I kept the decimals there, 307.6. Read on the exam, do they want it to the cent? Do they want it to the dollar? Read the fact, read the instructions. All right, Now, your interest payment's always constant. This hasn't changed for any of the examples we've done. Par value times a periodic coupon rate, $30,000. Now, the amortization will vary. It's going to be step three, your interest expense, minus step four, the interest payment. So our amortization here is 7307.6. All right, now we use all of this information for our amortization table. So here are the calculations we just did on the previous slide. Now, our amortization table here is a little different than straight line, right? And that's why I want to give you these handouts so you have the headings on how you set up your amortization table, how you do it for straight line, how you do it for effective interest method, okay? All right, so our first interest payment's made on June 30th. We know what our carrying value is, so that's easy. We know what our periodic market rate is. We know what our interest expense is. It is that carrying value times the periodic market rate. So we already did the math there. We know our interest payment doesn't change. It's always $30,000. Now our amortization is going to be the interest expense minus the interest payment is going to equal the amortization. And then we take our beginning carrying value. We subtract, excuse me, in this case, it's a discount. So we are pulling up. So we have to add it, right? We subtract it for a premium to pull down. We pull up, we add it if it's a discount. So you take your carrying value, you add the amortization, and that's going to give you your ending carrying value. All right. Then we do the same thing for the second payment, right? For the second interest payment, we know what our beginning carrying value is, whatever our ending carrying value was. So then what we're going to do, make sure you know your periodic market rate and your interest payments don't change. They are constant. But our interest expense and our amortization, they always vary, okay? They are going to vary. So you need to know that. All right. So we do the math on this. And keep this in mind. And what you're going to see with the carrying value, we're pulling the carrying value up, right? So that's this little note over here on the right. We have this carrying value. We have to pull it up so that we time it so that when we make the last interest payment, the carrying value always equals par value. All right. That, my friends, is key. All right. So let's take a look at the journal entries. So here's our little amortization for the first two payments. Now, these journal entries I just pulled up, these were the bond issuance journal entries. So this is what we've seen in the first example on January 1st. Now let's walk through for the effective interest method, what are the journal entries for the first interest payment on June 30th? Well, looking at it from the borrower's perspective, the issuer, there's going to be an interest expense, right? And we already calculated that. That's going to be our carrying value times our periodic market rate. And that's where we got 37,308. So that's an expense. So anytime we have a new expense, it's going to decrease our net income, decrease our retained earnings. So it lowers our equity. Then we have the discount on the bond payable, right? This is our amortization piece, right? We calculated the amortization. It's the difference between the interest expense and the interest payment. And now we amortize. And that's what we're going to use to pull up the carrying value, right? So again, that's our loss. That's our decrease of the contra liability. And then we have to credit the cash because we have to pay $30,000 interest payment, all right? So we have the asset going down. So if we look at all of this, we have the equity going down 37,308, but then we have the loss on a contra liability, which is like increasing a liability because it goes in the opposite direction. So the 37,308 less the 7,308 means the right side of our equation, liabilities plus equity is $30,000 down. And the left side, the assets, is $30,000 down. All right. So we're all in balance. Now, on the bondholder side, we have to debit the cash, $30,000, right? Because they're receiving the cash. So the cash that the bondholder is paying, excuse me, the bond issuer is paying, the bondholder receives. So they're increasing their bank account asset up $30,000. Now they have their investment in bonds. So this is where they're amortizing, right? Because this is going to be basically the amortization on their end. So this is their gain. And this is our plug number that we have to use to make our equation balance. And this is what we're using to pull up the carrying value, right? We're pulling up the carrying value of the asset. And then they have their bond interest revenue. So that's going to be the opposite of our expense. So the revenue is up. The equity is up. So you can see what we have going on here. We have the $30,000 asset increasing. Then we have the gain, which is going to increase the asset. So on the asset side, we're at $30,007,308. And on the increase on the equity side for the revenue, we're at $37,308. And we're all in balance. All right. Now, I just slid this first payment over to the left because I want to show you the second journal entry as well. So with the second journal entry, it's the exact same thing. The only thing is we have different numbers from our amortization table. And that's why the amortization table is key. Because on the exam, in a task-based simulation, they may ask you to calculate, you know, to enter the journal entries for the first two interest payments, where they may ask you, what's the carrying value after the third interest payment? And with your amortization table, all the answers reside in the amortization table, okay? So we have the bond interest expense of $37,600, which is a little different than what we had in the previous example for the first interest payment. So same thing, expenses up, equity is going to be down. Then we have our plug, the discount on our payables, which is the number we have to amortize is $7,600. That's going to be the loss, our decrease in our contra liability. And then we credit the cash, the $30,000, because we have to make that interest payment. So same as before. Exact same thing, only numbers are a little bit different. Thanks to our amortization table, we know what those numbers are, and we're all in balance. Then from the investor, the bondholder side, same thing. They debit the cash, they receive the $30,000 cash, increase the asset. Then they have their investment in bonds, which is what they have to amortize, which is their gain because they bought it at a discount. So the bondholder receives a gain in this one. And then we have to credit the bond interest revenue, which increases our equity. And again, assets up 37.6, equity up 37.6. We're all in balance. All right. So if you take a look at this, the journal entries for the first interest payment are identical to the journal entries for the second interest payment. The only thing that's different, the numbers I highlighted in yellow. The dollar amounts for the interest expense and the amortization are different, but the cash for the interest payment is the same. Same thing is true for the bondholder. If you look at what I highlighted in yellow, the cash is the same for the interest payment, but the investment in bonds and the bond revenue, that varies, all right? So make sure you understand the difference. And this is very different than straight line, where basically everything was the same. The journal entries were identical for every interest payment. But for the effective interest method, although the journal entries are the same, some of the dollar amounts will change. All right. Now, last major example we have is amortization on the effective interest method. And this is when we sell the bond at a premium. So how do we amortize when we sell the bond at a premium using the effective interest method? It's going to be just like what we did for a discount, all right, just from the other direction, okay? So coupon rate is 6, a periodic coupon rate is 3%, 8 periods. We now lowered the market rate from 8% to 4%. So our periodic market rate is 2%. So our market rate is less than our coupon rate. So we're selling at a premium. Now, we already did step number one for bond issuance. We know the bond selling price. That's the present value of the bond on January 1st, $1,073,000. That's step one. We've already done that. Step two, what's the premium? Take your par value, subtract the present value of the bond. And again, we take the absolute value. It's not a negative number. It just means that one is above par, and if it's a premium, one is below par if it's a discount. So our premium amount that we have to amortize, $73,280. Step number three, the interest expense is just our carrying value, which is our starting purchase price, the present value of the bond, times the periodic market rate of 2%, $21,465. Then we get our interest payment, never changes, $30,000. That's constant. Then we get our amortization. So it's going to be the interest expense less the interest payment. Again, we don't worry about negative numbers here. It just makes a difference. Are we above par or are we below par? All right. Okay, so now we have all of these numbers. So this is what we're going to use to create our amortization table. So here's all my calculations. I slid them up to the top of the slide like I did with the other examples. Let's make sure we understand these interest payments. So if we look at the first interest payment, June 30th, we know that the carrying value is the present value of the bond, the selling price, $1,073,000. So then we calculate the interest expense just by taking the carrying value times the periodic market rate, and we get the $21,465. Interest payment's always $30,000. Amortization is going to be the difference between the interest expense and the interest payment. And then we basically take the carrying value. Now we're pulling the carrying value down. Since it's a premium, it was sold above par. We have to pull it down to par value. So what we do is we take the carrying value, we subtract the amortization to pull the carrying value down towards par, all right? If you look at interest payment too, same thing. We now have the beginning carrying value is the same as our ending carrying value. Notice the periodic market rate and notice the interest payment, they don't change, they're constant. But the interest expense and the amortization, they vary, all right? They vary with every interest payment. Okay, so now if you look at this text on the right, what are we doing with the carrying value? We have to pull it down. When we sell at a premium, we pull it down to par value. So by the time we make that eighth interest payment, what's happening? Our carrying value is going to equal our par value. Okay. So now let's do our journal entries. So this is the first journal entry for the bond issuance. We see that on the left. Nothing changed. That was the earlier example. Now we're going to look at the first interest payment on June 30th. So from the borrower's perspective, the bond issuer, again, you have that interest expense. That's what we always start with. And we calculated that by taking the carrying value times the periodic market rate. And that basically is an expense. So it's going to lower our equity. Now we have to debit the premium on the bond payable. So this is our amortization amount, which basically is what we're going to have as our gain. Because now as the bondholder, remember, we're selling a $1 million bond for $1,073,000. So we're making an extra $73,000 on it. So if you take a look at that double-headed arrow on the left, initially on bond issuance, we have this liability of the $73,280. That's our gain. That's the gain on the premium. We could not recognize the gain immediately because of the matching principle, right? We have to do it over time with each successive interest payment. So this is the first time where we're going to recognize a piece of that gain through the amortization, okay? So what we're doing now is we're reversing that liability basically by the 8534. So that liability is going to go down. So we have equity going down 21,466. We have a liability going down 8534. Add those up and you're going to get $30,000, which is the same amount that we have to credit the cash to make the interest payment. So our assets are going down 30,000. Our liabilities plus equity are going down 30,000. And we're all in balance. Now, from the investor, the bondholder perspective, they're receiving that $30,000 interest payment, right? So they're going to debit the cash to increase their asset by $30,000. Now they have this investment in bonds. This is what they need to amortize, right? For them, it's a loss because they paid $1,073,000, but they're only getting back $1,000,000. So that $73,000 is where they're going to have to amortize that loss over each successive payment, okay? So they're decreasing that value of the investment in the bonds on their balance sheet, right? So that's how they're really recognizing this, because their investment in bonds goes down on the balance sheet. So we have this one asset going up 30,000, but then we have another asset going down, the 8534, which balances with the revenue that they recognize of 21 that increases equity. So on the asset side, we went up 21,466. On the equity side, we go up 21,466. So we're all in balance. Okay. All right. Now, that was the first payment, all right? The first journal entry for June 30th. Let's just look at the second one for December 31st. Same thing. We have to debit our bond interest expense by our new interest expense because the carrying value has changed. Therefore, the interest expense changed. So we're decreasing equity by 21,295. Then we have the premium on the bond is our amortization, right? So that's our gain, and that's going to reduce the liability by 8705, basically. And then we have to credit the cash for the interest payment we have to make of $30,000. So if we take a look at this, we have the equity down 21,295, liability down 8705, that equals 30,000, and we have the asset down. So we're all in balance. Asset goes down 30, liabilities and equity go down 30. Then on the bondholder side, they have to debit the cash because they're increasing their cash due to this interest payment received, so their asset goes up. Now they have to lower their investment in the bonds by the amortization. Why? because they paid $1,073,000, but they're only getting back $1 million. So they're decreasing their asset on their balance sheet by the amortization amount. Okay. Remember, we're pulling it down to par value. And of course, then we have to recognize, we have to credit the revenue for the bond interest, $21,95. So that's going to increase our equity. So asset goes up $21,295. Equity goes up $21,295. So we're good. If you take a look, journal entries for interest payment one and journal entries for interest payment two are identical. The only thing that's different, you have to go to the amortization table because your interest expense and your premium on bond payable changes, right? The amortization amount. Same thing is true for the bond holder. It's the same journal entries, but the dollar amounts change for the investment in bonds and for the bond interest revenue. Other than that, the journal entries are identical. All right. That, my friends, was the most important stuff we needed to go through. I just wanted to touch on the bond amortization when the bonds are issued between interest dates. Now, this gets a little more complex. And again, just to go through all that information I went through with you, we wouldn't have enough time to get through this, but I'm going to kind of just explain what it's all about. And then you really need to get into class to dive into the weeds, into the details on this one. So let's do this with the discount example. So here's what's going on. We know we have these bonds that are issued on January 1st and the interest is going to be paid June 30th and December 31st. But now what happens if basically bonds are sold sometime between January 1st and June 30th? Well, when that happens, you have to add any accrued interest to the purchase price. So the bond purchaser basically is going to pay the interest that they're not entitled to because they did not own the bonds at the time because they were in between interest payments. But when they get their first interest check, it's for a full period, but they didn't own them for a full period. So they have to pay the interest they're not entitled to upfront, and then they get reimbursed that. And I'm going to show you how it works. So here's the deal. Imagine you purchased the bonds on April 1st, but they were issued on January 1st, right? Bonds issued January 1st, but then you buy them on April 1st. That is right in between the interest payment date, like right in between the January 1st and the June 30th. So there's 3 months of interest that accrued from January 1st to March 31st. The bondholder basically is not entitled to, but they're going to receive it because on June 30th, they get paid the full 6 month interest payment. But they did not own them from January 1st to March 31st. So as I mentioned, what the bondholder does when they purchase it is they add that interest from January 1st to March 31st that they're not entitled to. So they say, all right, here's the interest that I'm not entitled to. On June 30th, pay it back to me. And that's exactly what happens, okay? So June 30th, they receive the full 6 month interest payment. So they get reimbursed the interest that they paid that they were not entitled to. All right, so I want to just show you something I have right here. It's a little timeline. January 1st is when the bonds are issued. June 30th is the first interest payment. April 1st, you come along and you purchase these bonds. So these first 3 months of the issues, bondholder did not own the bond in these first 3 months. So they're not entitled to the interest for these first 3 months. But when they get the interest payment on June 30th, it's for the full amount for all 6 months. So they're going to receive it anyway. So that's why they add the 3 months of interest they're not entitled to the purchase price. And then on June 30th, they get paid back. Okay. That's how it works. Now, once they own it from April 1st to June 30th, yeah, they're entitled to those 3 months of interest. They just were not entitled to the first 3 months of interest. Okay. So if you take a look at this, coupon rate 6%, periodic coupon rate 3%, 8 periods, periodic market rate is 4%. So we're selling at a discount. What we do is we take the bond selling price, the 932,690, like we've done, but now we have to add that accrued interest, which is your $1 million times the 3% times half of it, because it's only for 3 months, not 6 months, $15,000. So the total bond issuance price is 947,690. And then your journal entries, 94.7, that's the cash that basically is going to be paid. You have to pay, all right? So that is the, basically the bond purchaser is going to pay the bond issuer the 947,690. That's the first thing. Then we need to figure out this plug, the discount on the bond payable. So we know the bond payable is going to be $1 million. And we know the bond interest expense is $15,000. So to figure out the discount on the bond payable, what we do, we want to solve for number 4. So we add up the bond payable and the bond interest expense, and we subtract out the cash, and that's going to tell us our plug is $67,310. Now, what we're going to need to do after that with respect to the amortization of this is a whole nother ball game. All right. So we don't have time to get into that now, but I'm just kind of scratching the surface. Those are the next steps we have to do after this. Okay. All right, my friends, we are on the money. We have every one of these topics covered and covered well, covered in detail. You should now have a great understanding of bonds. And if you like the deep dive, I want you to be aware we have a lot of other deep dives coming up in FAR. We have lessee accounting. We have bonds coming up again, which you just did. Then we have consolidations, income tax, as well as not-for-profit accounting. You'll notice also we have them for reg. Here are your dates. We have them for bar, and we have them for audit. So they're all on our calendar. Now, we don't have TCP and ISC developed yet. Those are coming in 2025. But you see this little barcode that you can scan with your phone. If you want to get more information on signing up for the deep dives, here it all is right here. And they have some great discounts going on. So I highly recommend, if you found it useful and found it helpful, to click that little barcode scanner and get the information on that. Also, if you're not a Becker student yet, and you can't enroll in those deep dives I just showed you. Here's how you become one. They have a super large discount for Memorial Day going on right now, where you save a ton of money enrolling. And they also give you deep dives for free. They give you exam solver videos for free. So much stuff. We have another package called Concierge. If you really need individual training and tutoring, it comes with a tremendous amount of individual tutoring and training and really hand-holding, which is great for some people that need it. And they have like $1,000 off on that right now. Click this little barcode scanner right here, and you will be in great shape for getting all of this information, all right? So all of this stuff should be in the little handout that was sent to you as well. I want to give you my little LinkedIn again. So I'm going to just leave you with this. Whether you are a Becker student or you're not a Becker student, listen. I want nothing more for you than to get those three beautiful letters after your name, CPA. It has changed my life. It has changed the lives of many of my friends and colleagues, and it can change your life as well. And I know sometimes you're struggling and you feel like, oh my God, I don't get it. I can't do it. Believe me, you can, but you need a plan. A plan is the key, and we have success coaches to help out with that. We have tutors. We have academic support. We have all the resources you need, and we love to help students. That is our business. I have been teaching this since 1998, last century. I love it. I'm passionate about it. It's changed my life. I want it to change your life, and I believe in Becker and the Becker way because I help put all this stuff together, and I know the quality that goes into this. So I hope if you are a Becker student, you use all of these resources we have. If you're not a Becker student, we would love for you to become a Becker student, all right? But either way, feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn. Ask me any questions you want. I answer my questions and my messages all the time. I'm all over the social media stuff. So with that said, I really appreciate everyone spending 2 hours with me. I hope you found it a great use of your time. And I look forward to hearing from you when you get those three beautiful letters after your name, CPA, which, by the way, stands for coolest profession around. Believe me, it does. And when you are one, you will think so too. All right. So hit me on LinkedIn. Let me know how well you did on the exam or any questions you have. And I look forward to seeing you in class. Have a great night, everybody. We'll see you again in the next class. Be well.